Good evening, and thank you so much for joining us tonight. Hawaii's tourism industry is vital to our state's economy, creating businesses, jobs, and providing revenue to the state. But in recent years, there has been a renewed focus on the right tourism so that we don't overtax our natural resources and are respectful of the Hawaiian culture. Tonight, we're joined by stakeholders who are helping shape the future of tourism in the islands, which is even more important in the wake of the Lahaina wildfires. Mufi Hanneman is president and CEO of the Hawaii Lodging and Tourism Association. Thank you for being here. Interim president and CEO of the Hawaii Tourism Authority, Daniel Noho'opi'i. Thank you. And Tyler Gomes of Kilohana, the Tourism Division for the Council for Native Hawaiian Advancement. Thank you. Thank you all so much for joining us. So we want to jump right in with some questions about our industry. You know, how are we doing as far as numbers go? Who's coming here? What are they doing when they're here? Daniel, take us through the stats.
Sure. Let me give you an overview of where we are right now in the visitor industry. So as of 2023, there were 9.6 million visitors that came last year. However, that's about 7% down from where we were pre-COVID pandemic. And mainly, even though there's been a lot of expenditures, about $20 billion, and it has contributed quite significantly to our state revenue, we still are not where we want to be in terms of our international visitors. They still haven't come back, mainly because of policies in their countries, and they're slowly building back their access to Hawaii and the rest of the United States. And then we're also concerned going forward that there's talk of a recession or a slowdown, global recession and slowdown. So maybe in 25 and 26, there might be a little bit of hesitation in terms of people wanting to travel going forward. So we're really looking at setting the pace and ensuring that our marketing and programs encourage visitors to still come to Hawaii, respectively.
Regardless of how many, it will certainly be in the millions of tourists. So how can we manage the impact of those millions of visitors on our community, on our local resources, and what things are being done now to work toward that new future?
Well, I think we have to look at how the state has been marketed for so long, right? Which is sun, surf, sand, choose your own adventure, treasure island, all of those sort of sensationalized fantasy settings. And we created demand for that image. And in order to manage the impacts of the millions of visitors who are coming here, I think we have to change their expectations. So one, we have to acknowledge the diversity of options that are available to be marketed beyond sun, surf, sand. And then I think we have to start being very selective about the kinds of opportunities we're pushing out. I think there's an opportunity to shift and change what a visitor wants. And so that looks like re-engaging our visitors in that mindful space, that mindful headset of environmentalism, volunteerism, agritourism. And so in order to manage those impacts, I think one way, again, is shifting visitor mentality, but the second is re-empowering communities. Haena State Park is a great example of the community and the government coming together and coming up with a blueprint and a plan so that we're not saying, no, don't come to this part of our community, but we are saying we are going to manage and control how many of you come, when you come, whether or not you're paying, how you're shuttled in. So I think on both of those ends, both the way we touch and engage our residents, but also the visitors, we can shift the impacts overall.
Sure, and you mentioned residents, and that is so important. You know, what is the state and the tourism industry doing to manage tourism and engage those residents in the planning for the future of tourism in their islands? Mufi.
Yes, so I'm gonna answer this question not just as the head of HLTA, but also as the chairman of the board of the Hawaii Tourism Authority, working very closely with Daniel. Because I think what they've done is a real model. For the past 5 years, they've had a strategic plan that takes into account what we call destination management, which really encourages resident input in terms of things that they feel very strongly about that has resulted in overcrowding or degradation of resources, and then coming up with very solutions-active emphasis to make sure that we're also not just talking about the problem, but we're also addressing it, and then bringing together all the agencies that need to be a part of it. So this is a big shift from what we used to do with an emphasis on destination marketing. But now we're talking about destination management. So this involves the counties. It's a plan that has already gone through phase one, phase two. We hope to complete by the end of this year. And then we'll see, I think, a very concerted effort led by Kilohana that now has the destination management contract with the Hawaii Tourism Authority to carry out what the people of Hawaii want.
And these are not plans that are just going to end up on a shelf. They'll
exactly
be lived and breathed.
All and right. funded.
and funded, most importantly. Well, we do have a short break, and when we return, we'll talk more about the reshaping of the tourism industry. Welcome back to our empowered discussion about the future of tourism. We want to talk about the so-called paradigm shift for Hawaii marketing the islands. And how are we changing our perspective to improve the island experience for visitors and also residents? Daniel.
Okay, so the Tourism Authority has kind of a three-prong approach. First, Tyler mentioned about marketing to the right kind of visitors, finding those visitors who are mindful, who are who spend the money but do the proper kinds of activities. They're seeking out educational, contributing back to the our community. And then the second approach is the destination management. So working with communities to empower them to be able to take care of the roadways and the parks that are nearby them, to be stewards of their area. And then the third approach is developing the new experiences, those that are more regenerative in nature, that contribute back to community, empower community development and local economic development. And so we're actually, one of Kilohana's contracts is to train interested communities to be involved in the visitor industry.
Oh, to actually have activities come to them in a new sense.
Yep, that's right. It's really exciting, but I think we have to figure out what those communities need first.
Bring money, but visitors, the right visitors.
Right.
That's right. So you mentioned that word regenerative. Let's talk a little bit more about that phrase, regenerative tourism. Mufi, how does that differ from other phrases we've heard over the years? Ecotourism, sustainable tourism. How's regenerative different?
Yeah, that's a great question. When you talk about sustainable tourism, when you talk about ecotourism, it's all about making sure that what you're doing and enjoying today can be preserved in the future, for future generations. Regenerative tourism is really a deeper dive into it. It's all about making sure that the actions of businesses, of residents, of our visitors, really reflect a proactive approach to ensure that the goals of sustainable tourism and ecotourism are sustained and preserved into the future. So let's talk about what we always say here, buy local, mm-hmm. shop local, take something back that is local. That's very important that we continue to do that. I want to applaud the Council of Native Hawaiian Advancement for coming up with the latest regenerative tourism example as I see in Waikiki, and that's the Kilohana Hula Show. This is something that people enjoyed for years, for decades, through the years. They brought it back, but there's some regenerative tourism aspects to that. There's an opportunity to see how native plants that we have here in our islands. There's a pop-up makeke element to it that allows people to buy local products from Hawaii and the like. And then when you look at what other hotels are doing to ensure that, I love what Turtle Bay is doing on the North Shore in partnering with Kupu, with Kualima, farms to make sure that 70% of the food ingredients that are used at Turtle Bay comes from Hulima Farms. And then they have an element of a farm tour that shows why sustainable agriculture and ag tourism works. And we have numerous hotels across the board, Outrigger Hotels, Alohi'alani Hotels, hotels that are all practicing conservation, energy efficiency, all the kinds of things that we'd like to see, and then encouraging people to be a part of it.
Sure, and you know, you mentioned the Turtle Bay, the Kualima Farm, and these are things that locals can enjoy on their staycations
exactly.
too.
Yes.
Wonderful. Now, what are some of the ideas about educating visitors on Hawaiian culture and sustaining the environment, improving the overall experience for the guests at the same time and the residents? So some more examples of how tourists would participate in that regenerative tourism program.
I think the common example people look at is, you know, using the Hawaiian language in prevalent places. And for a long time, we heard the counter argument that visitors don't care enough or aren't interested to know what the language is, and there's all that resistance. And here we are 20 years later, and now it's much more prevalent, right? And so we take that same approach to the way in which we're being selective, like I mentioned, about what is authentic in Hawaiian culture and how we're presenting it. So as an example of the Kilohana Hula Show, which Mufi mentioned, we're very specific in that we don't feature the arts and practices of other Polynesian cultures, not to diminish them, but to give the visitor a very uniquely Hawaiian experience that doesn't conflate and confuse in that sort of Polynesian fusion vibe. But more importantly, I think, you know, there are so many environmental and agricultural experiences here on the island that are not utilized to their fullest. The obvious examples are lo'i and loku'i'a, our fish ponds and our taro patches. I think sometimes they get diminished as sort of primitive experiences. People diminish them because it's getting in the earth, but that's important to us as a people, as a culture. And so I think if we reframe the visitor expectation, I think we have an opportunity to shift their perspective and enjoy it. But beyond that, and you know, Senator Dela Cruz has done so much work in trying to reinvigorate agriculture. In many countries around the world where they produce all kinds of agricultural products, they are able to turn those into regenerative experiences by creating tours for visitors who learn how these products are made. And in doing so, you create this vertically integrated process of not only creating great agricultural products, but making sure the visitors see how they're made and then they purchase them, and creating a circular economy. And so these are some examples of, you know, how do we take what's already existing in the state, but market it in a better way that activates the visitor and actually treats them like it's something they would be interested in versus assuming that it's not something that they would want to participate in.
Yeah, you'd be surprised what people will enjoy if you offer it to them. Well, when we come back, we'll talk more about rebuilding tourism on Maui and how we can support those efforts. Welcome back to Empowered. We want to talk now about how the strategy for the future of tourism changes depending on the island. Are there different needs for Kauai, Oahu, Hawaii Island, and Maui? Daniel?
Sure. So the Hawaii Tourism Authority went through a process about 3 years ago called the Destination Management Action Plans. And that's working with the communities on each island to identify what are some of the hot spots, problem issues related to their island, and what would be excellent ways of improving the conditions for visitors and residents. So for example, on Hawaii Island, they wanted to promote more community-based stewardship programs. So in Keokaha and then out in Pohuiki and other places, there are actually communities that are managing the sites and the areas, telling visitors what to do, where they can go that's safe, at the same time providing cultural education and information for visitors and residents. On Lanai, on the other hand, they wanted to encourage more visitors to come up to, you know, the Lanai Center itself and participate in small businesses. Not only the resort, but Lanai also known for its cultural heritage and the small businesses there. On Molokai, it was more about how can we get more communities to sponsor some of these events so they have more ideas, and then by doing that, generating more community economic development, as well as creating information that's more accurate to specifically Molokai and what the kind of issues that they have and related to visitors coming on their island. It's on Oahu, we looked at, you know, the reservation systems like Hanama Bay reservations, and it's working really well on this island, and encouraging other parks and areas to work with DLNR or work with the state and the county to develop more reservation systems, guiding people to go to the right places, and if it's full, then look for another place that also can be accepted. So there's choices and options. Kauai, you know, I'm sure you've heard of the success of how the North and Hanalei going beyond to Haena, making sure that there's a shuttle system to alleviate parking and crowding. But now we want to work on other areas on Kauai as well and implementing similar processes and working with the community on that. And then of course, Maui. Prior to the fire, one of their main issues was congestion overall. You know, there's a lot of, the visitor industry is strong on Maui, which is good for the economy, but also it has led to certain issues. Like in the resort area, they felt there were too many cars because people were taking a car and then trying to travel to each destination site or just going back and forth at the airport. So early we worked on a shuttle system with the county, people movers and things like that. And then also along the road to Hana, communities wanted to step in and help to guide, make sure visitors, as they come along, park in the right places. So there are people out there now making a little money as well as working hard to tell about their story at the same time guiding visitors where they want to go. But then after fire, maybe we want to talk about some of the other things that have happened since then.
Yeah, that's a very important part. You know, on that front, discussing the specific issues on Maui as that island recovers from the devastating wildfires. We obviously need tourism and need the right kinds of tourists. So what does the tourism industry look like on Maui now? How are residents coping with the need to have tourism, to have jobs, and to go through their own struggles? And what can we all do to support Maui's recovery? Mufi?
Yes. So I just want to just add something to what Daniel just said. On this whole destination management process, one of our major priorities before the legislature is to codify that. to make sure that it's part of what Hawaii Tourism Authority does. When it was first established, it was all about marketing. So we want to make sure, long after Daniel's gone, I'm gone, Tyler's gone, that whoever takes these positions, they recognize that it is what the community wants. It's in the statute, and that's what HTA is going to do. Having said that, I think we want to get back to what Don Hole used to sing about many years ago. They say that Maui, no ka'oe. We want to get back to that. Maui has gone through tremendous pain and suffering, $16 billion in damages that has occurred there. So we have to make sure that we address the needs. And number one is housing. We recognize that. We fully support what Governor Green's trying to do, Mayor Bisson, in trying to make sure that we can get people to a better place, to more permanent housing, because that is also exacerbating the problem that we have with hotels, trying to welcome visitors back. Visitors are going to be respectful and mindful. So the numbers on Maui are obviously down. That's a given. But we've also embarked on a Makaukau Maui campaign right now to let people know that the residents on Maui want their economy to start moving again. It's the most dependent county in the state on tourism. So this is going to require a lot of effort across the board to ensure that we are bringing the mindful, respectful visitors back. We appreciate the patience that the Maui folks have had in trying to address their housing issues and the like. But there's no question, if we don't start moving the needle on getting the visitors back on Maui, it's going to have major implications for years and years and years to come. We know that there's a sense that maybe the numbers are up on Maui, because if you look at the occupancy rate, hey, they're hovering near 80%. They must have a lot of people there. But keep in mind, there are hundreds of federal workers that are in the hotels. There are lots of residents that are still housed in the hotels. That's why asking the short-term rental owners is the best solution right now, as the governor is trying to do and the mayor, to basically free up some of that inventory of housing so we can get people there. They'll feel better, and then as they go back to work, you know, we've basically resolved many of the issues that they're concerned about, housing and their jobs.
Now, as those numbers remain down and suppressed a bit on Maui for visitors, are we losing those visitors entirely from Hawaii, or are we seeing them adjust their plans? Are they going to other islands? You know, Mufi, we'll start with you. What are you seeing?
Well, I think there's a concerted effort to have them go to other islands. We know that, for example, many of the hotels that have properties on other islands are encouraging them, you know, maybe not in Lahaina, obviously, but other parts. You know, certainly other parts of West Maui are open. And there's really a tremendous sense of camaraderie amongst the hotels. They're all cooperating. It's not like, bring them all to my property. If your property is good and set to go, we're encouraging them to stay here. So that's why in our plans with the Hawaii Tourism Authority, it's encouraging visitors not just back to Maui, but to the rest of the state.
Well, we'll be back with some final thoughts right after this short break. Well, welcome back as we talk about ways to adjust the tourism industry. One of the ideas that's being proposed to help improve our resources is a green fee that's under discussion at the legislature. Mufi, is that something that the industry welcomes, and what is it?
Well, we're open to it, but let me just say at the outset, when you take into account that the state charges a 10% tourism tax, the counties now have another 3% on top of that. That's 13%. When you take into account that visitors pay the GET, that's another 4%. Percent plus. That's 18% across the board, not even counting what they pay also for renting a car. With that being said, we're very much opposed to any raising of the transit accommodation tax. However, on the green fee, we're open to a discussion. But we'd like to proffer that it follow the Hanama Bay model that I had the opportunity to champion when I was on the city council. It's an impact user fee. So whatever you assess a visitor at these so-called hotspots, it goes back to that particular attraction, so that visitors will know, residents will know, that as they visit it in years to come, these type of issues are being addressed. And so we see that more in keeping with these type of fees can be in concert with, will help the community as well as visitors that come in, an impact user fee type of model.
And so that revenue is so important. We don't want them to feel so nickel and dimed in fees that they don't want to spend at the restaurants and the stores. How important is revenue, and how can we get more of it?
So the important concept here, part of regenerative tourism, is that the revenue is being spent at the local level, so the money goes immediately back into the community. So what we do as part of the Tourism Authority's marketing is not only encourage the right visitors to come, but encourage them to spend local markets, to offer new businesses that across the islands, and by doing so, they generate more revenue, which results in more tax revenue as well.
Well, as in our closing thoughts, from your perspective, what do you want the residents, the viewers home to know about the future of tourism in Hawaii as you see it?
Well, in speaking for Kilohana and by proxy, the Council for Native Hawaiian Advancement, we've always challenged the status quo, and we always will do so no matter what we're working on. And so I think we really want to focus on challenging our visitors to expect more, to be more curious about the things we want them to be respectful and thoughtful. And in doing so, we're hopeful that going back to this idea of diversity and selectivity, we really give them strong value add opportunities that improve both the destination and make the destination healthy, but also improve the experience overall for the visitor.
What's in your crystal ball?
Okay, so as a state agency, I just wanted to lay out kind of our strategic plan going forward. So in this coming year, it's really about ensuring that recovery from Maui visitors, from Oahu, from the U.S. and Canada, et cetera, and start to strengthen our international visitors, right? And then we mentioned about destination management. So the next couple of years, ensuring that destination management is integrated into our processes and it's island-based, island-controlled. And then finally shifting in the next 5 years to regenerative tourism as the primary type of visitors and tourism that happens here in Hawaii.
Mm-hmm. Mufi.
You know, Gina, I've been involved with every economic diversification initiative over the past 40 years. And as noble as those intentions have been from our federal leaders, our state leaders, our county leaders, we've always fallen short, and it's come back to tourism. I know people don't like to hear that, but at the end of the day, in my opinion, it'll still be tourism, but it'll be a different kind of tourism model. All the things that we've talked about today, regenerative tourism. I've also said, you know, if tourism is our core competence, then let's synergize it with other sectors that perhaps can show some demonstrated success in jobs, whether it's film, culture and arts, whether it's sports. Those are proven winners. We're going to have the Fest back here in June that's going to have nations throughout the Pacific that are going to come here. Culture, arts, but also we're going to be doing great things for our country because we want to keep them with a friendly relationship with the United States, and Hawaii is the perfect model to do that. So that's the type of tourism that I see happening, basically drawing upon our core competence, but ensuring that we're going to have people that want to work and engage. We're going to redouble our efforts with workforce development, another initiative that's been championed by Senator Dela Cruz, so that people want to go to the industry. They see it not as a court of last resort if you can't find a job anywhere else. It's something that you want to go to because it's appealing, it's attractive, and it's all about keeping Hawaii special. Hawaii is very important. We understand that, and that's why regenerative tourism, in my opinion, should be the road and the path into the future.
That's right. Without the people, there is not that spirit of
exactly.
Aloha.
Exactly.
Yes.
All right. Well, that's all the time that we have time for tonight. And we do thank our panelists so much for sharing your mana'o and your wisdom on this matter. And thank you all for watching about the future of Hawaii's tourism industry. Mahalo.